Welcome back to the channel, everyone. You know where we're at. We're at PWA here in Katy, Texas, and we got another weld demo for you today. Now, you guys are going to have to pardon the noise. Here at PWA, these guys are ripping and tearing, practicing all different shapes and sizes of welding. That's what we're going to talk a little bit about today. Not necessarily the stuff that's usually found in schools, but actually welding handrails. Believe it or not, there's a lot of lucrative business when it comes to this right here. And when it comes to pipe welding, even though it is a circular piece of metal, I've seen a lot of pipe welders mess the frick up on some handrails. Just like welding codes for high pressure piping, believe it or not, there is code for handrails. That goes into specific sizing, the diameter of handrails, max and a minimum, and the thickness depending on if it's a handrail or if it's a guardrail. They're usually prefabbed in shops and then usually brought to site to install. Sometimes they're either installed on site or you have to come in and do some repairs. So that's what today's episode is going to be about. Prepping our tubing is going to be one of the biggest aspects of it. We've got a little bevel on all of our tubing because we do want to put a little bit of penetration in it since we are going to be blending these welds afterwards. We don't want our weld to just sit on top with minimum penetration because as we go to blend that weld off, we're not going to have a whole lot holding us there. So we are going to take this tubing and put a bevel on everything and make sure that we've got enough bevel so that when we put a weld, we get the penetration needed after we blend everything in. That's where usually a lot of welders mess up. They might put a decent weld on it, but once it's blended, you're gonna start seeing some cracks. We're gonna add another kind of element to this. We're gonna be throwing a little bit of cold galv on today's project too, because a lot of these handrails that you're gonna face are galvanized. So let's check things out. Now, like I said, there is gonna be some galvanized coating on this. I didn't bring my personal respirator, so I'm gonna push this Donaldson fume extractor over there so we don't fog anyone up, because you know that galvanized is pretty nasty. And not to mention only welding on the galvanized, we're also gonna be running a self-shielded Fluxcore process with no gas, and it's pretty smoky too. It just kind of goes hand in hand to this whole field application and handrails we're trying to accomplish. Welcome into our humble home for the day. This is booth number 12. As you know, PWA is equipped with 80 plus booths, all hooked up to ESOB welding equipment like these Warriors, these ESOB Rebel 285s, which we're gonna be running off of today, and of course it has the Rogues, the whole line of ESOB products here throughout all these booths. I've got it hooked up with our self-shielded flux core wire. Like I mentioned, we're not gonna run any gas. This is more of a wire for a field application, something that you might find common in handrail repairs or fabrication. And I've hooked up my Abacore bezel gun. It's a little bit more ergonomic and lightweight for me as we work around these smaller size tubing. Of course, got the Donaldson fume extractor pulled over here. Got it cranked on. We're gonna have it sucking up all these fumes from the Fluxcore and the galvanized material. As far as settings, we got about 17.5 on the voltage and 250 on the wire feed speed. Remember, with self-shielded Fluxcore wire, unlike dual-shield Fluxcore wire, we're gonna be running DCEN today instead of EP. That's gonna help us have a little bit smoother weld. This is gonna be our handrail coupon, if you will. It's a jig that I designed that has all different types of handrail fits, where the 90s come together in your butt welds, where we bevel them to maybe even a fish mouth or a saddle. Those are gonna be welded. And of course, it wouldn't be handrail work if we didn't have a little bit of a bad gap here and there on some butt welds. We've got it completely covered in cold galv, galvanized paint, so we're gonna make sure we get rid of that before we move on. Now all that's left to do is to weld some handrails. Galvanized steel is not a tricky metal to weld. It's just steel. It's steel with a bunch of schmutz all over it, right? In order to weld galvanized, you gotta clean the galvanized coating off. So to do so, I use this 3M cleaning strip. If you guys watch the channel, you know that I use the crap out of these things. It's one of the best alternatives to a wire wheel. Now, I did use a wire wheel to get in some of the deeper spots, but that cleaning strip takes off all this galvanized coating, no problem. It doesn't throw any crazy wires around when you get into these weird spots. As you can see, it cleans all the stuff that we need off. It's just steel underneath that. Now, usually you're not going to be able to clean off 100% of that galvanized coating, and you are usually going to have to reapply it in somehow, some way, shape, or form. So I've got my Donaldson fume extractor. I'm going to try to keep my head out of the fume plume as best as possible because this galvanized is going to get hot. It's going to want to burn off. I don't have a personal respirator today. I wish I brought it, but I didn't. So I'm making sure that I got this fume extractor close enough to pull all that poisonous zinc fumes away. Now we can go about making our welds with this self-shielded Fluxcore wire. When it comes to handrail work, don't get me lying, there is no direction of weld that says you have to weld from bottom to top or top to bottom. One of those things is just get a good solid weld on there. Solid. Notice we have bevels somewhere to where we're gonna get most joint penetration or complete joint penetration, because we're going to take all of the reinforcement off it when we go to blend it. And there is a good way to blend it. I'll show you that when we get to it. Let's freaking weld something already. 17 volts, 250 on the wire. We're going to go bottom to top, see how that works out for us. Not too bad. It felt a little spicy, like it wanted to dig, but it's filling itself back in, and that's what we want to see. We want to see that depth of penetration. We want to see that dig, but that wire is filling fast enough to fill us up flush. We want to just get right past flush, but we don't want to have a big heavy cap, because then we got to grind more. The hard part about tubing is the fact that it's thin. Now, can we weld this downhill? That's another question. A little bit of an angle issue there. Probably my favorite part about a handrail is the fact that it's mostly just get some weld on there. Now I'm going to just be honest with y'all, I haven't welded such a Fluxcore in a long time. It looks like our downhill weld was very successful. Comparatively speaking to the uphill that had a lot of dig, I think we're going to get plenty of penetration with the downhill. We just need to make sure that every portion of this weld is past flush. We don't want any low points, because then we're going to have a low point in our blend. And the big thing here is we don't want any of these big high nuggets on the bottom, because that's going to be more to grind. Our goal with a handrail is to get complete joint penetration, or at least as much penetration as possible with as little reinforcement as possible, so we don't have to do as much grinding as possible. For the rest of these welds, these 5G welds, we're gonna run them downhill. And same thing with these saddles, they're probably likely gonna be welded downhill. We just wanna make solid fusion and be able to grind it off after. Let's go for this weld here, try it downhill. The biggest thing, man, is even on my first downhill, I noticed that I'm not maintaining that gun angle. We gotta whip this gun around. That's the hardest part here. I think that went way better than the first weld. So if you start losing that gun angle, just quit and get a restart, reposition. Make sure we can get to that bottom tie-in and not leave a big lump. Okay, even with these downhill welds, I can still see I'm getting a lot of depth. I'm seeing that puddle sink, and that's what I want to see. This weld on the top is going to be a different story. It's got a lot more gap to go in, and we might have to adjust some settings. I'm going to bump this down to 16.7 and 200. Those current settings are going to be a little too hot for this bit of a gap. Now this is inch and a half pipe, schedule 40. The wall thickness is just over a quarter of an inch. So it does have some heat holding capabilities. Okay, here we go. Probably gonna have to do this a quarter at a time. The big thing when you do something like this, you want to stay on your weld and don't get in front of it too much. With this self-shielded Fluxcore process, like I said, we want to sit on that top of that weld. With it having that gap, it's going to get you your fusion that you want, even without the bevel. Want to maintain about 3/8, half inch contact tip to work distance. And it really doesn't weld all that challenging. As long as you stay on your weld and don't let that wire go through the back. You can might throw a little bit of side to side on there. But remember, I'm not looking for a wide and tall bead. I'm looking for a flat and skinny bead for less grinding. Can't see the bottom there, Cap'n. I don't know, if you're building handrails and welding them like this, it's not usually the order you go about it. Normally you'd prefab them, not coated or galvanized, and then they'd go about building the handrail, and then they'll galvanize it. But the people installing probably have to do a little bit of this, and of course the people that are doing the repairs. Where I've had this actually in my experience was building handrails or welding the handrails for a power plant when there wasn't any pipe welds to be made. They'd stick you on some handrails already tacked and they had crap on them, and you definitely had to clean them up just like we did today. That one welded pretty good. I like that one. Now, while I'm down here, I might as well knock out these 2G welds. Shouldn't be as hard. Definitely not trying to get ahead of my puddle. Got to stay on top of that weld. Like I said, it's not exactly about what you put on as much as it is about how much you put on and that it at least covers the weld groove. I'd like to see myself be able to get all the way around at least halfway, but it's not always the case. You really got to plan your way out on these types of welds. If I know I'm going to finish right here on halfway, I'm going to try to start very uncomfortable and work towards this very comfortable spot. I can't see too good at this point. I know I'm getting it, and then as I work towards coming around, I'm really starting to see what I'm working with. I'm really comfortable for where I'm going. I can make that full half of a weld instead of quartering things out, and maybe even go a little bit further. But you just gotta plan for it.
Now I just wanna go ahead and get the rest of these welds finished up. I do think this is a pretty humbling experience with all these different joint configurations that are on this coupon. You really have to set yourself up for success if you want to make a lengthy weld or at least make half of that weld join up. Now, after we've got all that weld done, you're going to notice we might have a little bit of a low spot or a high spot. Now it's time we do all the blending. That's the whole point of having enough metal there in the first place. If you do see a low spot, you should probably go ahead and dab it up, get it full, even if it doesn't look good, because we're going to go ahead and sand everything down. Now, I'll be honest with you guys, I got into a bit of a hurry at this point. Even with an angle grinder, you can be pretty consistent with your finishing. However, I was rushing things too much. I could have done a couple other things in order to be a little bit more meticulous, be a little slower. You can always take off a little bit more. You usually can't put it back, especially if you notice we kind of dished out some of the sides of the welds. And even after paint, it isn't necessarily the most desirable finish out there. Is it the worst thing in the world? No, it was nice and smooth, but you can tell we didn't take the meticulous time needed with that right tool, maybe an angle grinder, maybe something different, to really put a nicer finish on a handrail. That way you can't see it through paint or powder coat. That being said, if you guys want to see some content like that on the maybe the quality of levels of different blending where you can get paid, you know, just to get it done versus getting paid a lot more to get it done and then some to make it look right. Let us know if that's what you want to see in the comments below. I'd be more than happy to try again and spend a little bit more time to make it look silky smooth for you. We'll see you guys on the next weld.
7 and 200. I just have a feeling those current settings are going to be a little too hot for this bit of a gap.